Atlantis. Atlantis, Island of Atlas, is a fictional island mentioned within an allegory on the hubris of nations in Plato's works Timaeus and Critias, where it represents the antagonist naval power that besieges ancient Athens, the pseudo-historic embodiment of Plato's ideal state in the Republic. In the story, Athens repels the Atlantean attack unlike any other nation of the known world, supposedly giving testament to the superiority of Plato's concept of a state. The story concludes with Atlantis falling out of favor with the deities and submerging into the Atlantic Ocean. Despite its minor importance in Plato's work, the Atlantis story has had a considerable impact on literature. The allegorical aspect of Atlantis was taken up in utopian works of several Renaissance writers, such as Francis Bacon's New Atlantis and Thomas More's Utopia. On the other hand, 19th-century amateur scholars misinterpreted Plato's narrative as historical tradition, most notably in Ignatius L. Donnelly's. Plato's vague indications of the time of the events, more than 9,000 years before his time, and the alleged location of Atlantis, beyond the Pillars of Hercules has led to much pseudoscientific speculation. As a consequence, Atlantis has become a byword for any and all supposed advanced prehistoric lost civilizations and continues to inspire contemporary fiction, from comic books to films. While present-day philologists and classicists agree on the story's fictional character, there is still debate on what served as its inspiration. As for instance with the story of Gyges, Plato is known to have freely borrowed some of his allegories and metaphors from older traditions. This led a number of scholars to investigate possible inspiration of Atlantis from Egyptian records of the Thera eruption, the Sea People's invasion, or the Trojan War. Others have rejected this chain of tradition as implausible and insist that Plato created an entirely fictional nation as his example, drawing loose inspiration from contemporary events such as the failed Athenian invasion of Sicily in 415 to 413 BC or the destruction of Helike in 373 BC. The only primary sources for Atlantis are Plato's dialogues Timaeus and Critias. All other mentions of the island are based on them. The dialogues claim to quote Solon, who visited Egypt between 590 and 580 BC, they state that he translated Egyptian records of Atlantis. Written in 360 BC, Plato introduced Atlantis and Timaeus. The four people appearing in those two dialogues are the politicians Critias and Hermocrates, as well as the philosophers Socrates and Timaeus of Locri, although only Critias speaks of Atlantis. In his works, Plato makes extensive use of the Socratic method in order to discuss contrary positions within the context of a supposition. The Timaeus begins with an introduction, followed by an account of the creations and structure of the universe and ancient civilizations. In the introduction, Socrates muses about the perfect society, described in Plato's Republic, circa 380 BC, and wonders if he and his guests might recollect a story which exemplifies such a society. Critias mentions a tale he considered to be historical, that would make the perfect example, and he then follows by describing Atlantis as is recorded in the Critias. In his account, ancient Athens seems to represent the perfect society and Atlantis its opponent, representing the very antithesis of the perfect traits described in the Republic. According to Critias, the Hellenic deities of old divided the land so that each deity might have their own lot. Poseidon was appropriately, and to his liking, bequeathed the island of Atlantis. The island was larger than ancient Libya and Asia Minor combined, but it was later sunk by an earthquake and became an impassable mud shoal, inhibiting travel to any part of the ocean. Plato asserted that the Egyptians described Atlantis as an island consisting mostly of mountains in the northern portions and along the shore and encompassing a great plain in an oblong shape in the south, extending in one direction 3,000 stadia, about 555 kilometers, 345 miles. But across the center inland it was 2,000 stadia, about 370 kilometers, 230 miles. 50 stadia, 9 kilometers, 6 miles, from the coast was a mountain that was low on all sides, broken off all round about. The central island itself was 5 stades in diameter, about 0.92 kilometers, 0.57 miles. In Plato's metaphorical tale, Poseidon fell in love with Cleito, the daughter of Evanor and Lysippe, who bore him 5 pairs of male twins. The eldest of these, Atlas, was made rightful king of the entire island and the ocean, called the Atlantic Ocean in his honor, and was given the mountain off his birth and the surrounding area as his fiefdom. Atlas's twin Gadeirus, or Eumelus in Greek, was given the extremity of the island toward the Pillars of Hercules. The other 4 pairs of twins, Amphares and Evaemon, Nicias and Autochthon, Elasippus and Mestor, and Azis and Diopreibs, were also given rule over many men, and a large territory. Poseidon carved the mountain where his love dwelt into a palace and enclosed it with three circular moats of increasing width, varying from 1 to 3 stadion separated by rings of land proportional in size. The Atlanteans then built bridges northward from the mountain, making a route to the rest of the island. They dug a great canal to the sea, and alongside the bridges carved tunnels into the rings of rock so that ships could pass into the city around the mountain. They carved docks from the rock walls of the moats. Every passage to the city was guarded by gates and towers, and a wall surrounded each ring of the city. The walls were constructed of red, white, and black rock, quarried from the moats, and were covered with brass, tin, and the precious metal rich alcum, respectively. According to Critias, 9,000 years before his lifetime, a war took place between those outside the Pillars of Hercules at the Strait of Gibraltar and those who dwelt within them. The Atlanteans had conquered the parts of Libya within the Pillars of Hercules, as far as Egypt, and the European continent as far as Tyrrhenia, and had subjected its people to slavery. The Athenians led an alliance of resistors against the Atlantean Empire, and as the alliance disintegrated, prevailed alone against the empire, liberating the occupied lands. The logographer Hellanicus of Lesbos wrote an earlier work entitled Atlantis, of which only a few fragments survived. Hellanicus' work appears to have been a genealogical one concerning the daughters of Atlas, Tau Lambda Alpha Nu Tau Sigma in Greek means of Atlas, but some authors have suggested a possible connection with Plato's island. John Vialus notes that when Plato writes about the genealogy of Atlantis's kings, he writes in the same style as Hellanicus, suggesting a similarity between a fragment of Hellanicus's work and an account in the Critias. Rodney Castledon suggests that Plato may have borrowed his title from Hellanicus, who may have based his work on an earlier work about Atlantis. Castledon has pointed out that Plato wrote of Atlantis in 359 BC, when he returned to Athens from Sicily. He notes a number of parallels between the physical organization and fortifications of Syracuse and Plato's description of Atlantis. Gunnar Rudberg was the first who elaborated upon the idea that Plato's attempt to realize his political ideas in the city of Syracuse could have heavily inspired the Atlantis account. Some ancient writers viewed Atlantis as fictional or metaphorical myth, others believed it to be real. Aristotle believed that Plato, his teacher, had invented the island to teach philosophy. The philosopher Crantor, a student of Plato's student Xenocrates, is cited often as an example of a writer who thought the story to be historical fact. His work, A Commentary on Timaeus, is lost, but Proclus, a Neoplatonist of the 5th century AD, reports on it. The passage in question has been represented in the modern literature either as claiming that Crantor visited Egypt, had conversations with priests, and saw hieroglyphs confirming the story, or as claiming that he learned about them from other visitors to Egypt. Proclus wrote. The next sentence is often translated. Crantor adds, that this is testified by the prophets of the Egyptians, who assert that these particulars, which are narrated by Plato, are written on pillars which are still preserved. But in the original, the sentence starts not with the name Crantor but with the ambiguous he. Whether this referred to Crantor or to Plato is the subject of considerable debate. Proponents of both Atlantis as a metaphorical myth and Atlantis as history have argued that the pronoun refers to Crantor. Alan Cameron argues that the pronoun should be interpreted as referring to Plato, and that, when Proclus writes that we must bear in mind concerning this whole feat of the Athenians, that it is neither a mere myth nor unadorned history, although some take it as history and others as myth, he is treating Crantor's view as mere personal opinion, nothing more. In fact, he first quotes and then dismisses it as representing one of the two unacceptable extremes. Cameron also points out that whether he refers to Plato or to Crantor, the statement does not support conclusions such as Otto Mux Crantor came to say and saw there in the Temple of Neith the column, completely covered with hieroglyphs, on which the history of Atlantis was recorded. Scholars translated it for him, and he testified that their account fully agreed with Plato's account of Atlantis or J.V. Luce's suggestion that Crantor sent a special inquiry to Egypt and that he may simply be referring to Plato's own claims. Another passage from the commentary by Proclus on the Timaeus gives a description of the geography of Atlantis. Marcellus remains unidentified. Other ancient historians and philosophers who believed in the existence of Atlantis were Strabo and Posidonius. Some have theorized that, before the 6th century BC, the Pillars of Hercules may have applied to mountains on either side of the Gulf of Laconia, and also may have been part of the pillar cult of the Aegean. The mountains stood at either side of the southernmost gulf in Greece, the largest in the Peloponnese, and it opens onto the Mediterranean Sea. This would have placed Atlantis in the Mediterranean, lending credence to many details in Plato's discussion. The 4th century historian Ammianus Marcellinus, relying on a lost work by Timagenes, a historian writing in the 1st century BC, writes that the Druids of Gaul said that part of the inhabitants of Gaul had migrated there from distant islands. Some have understood Ammianus's testimony as a claim that at the time of Atlantis' sinking into the sea, its inhabitants fled to Western Europe, but Ammianus, in fact, says that the Dracidae, Druids, recall that a part of the population is indigenous but others also migrated in from islands and lands beyond the Rhine, Res Gestae 15.9, an indication that the immigrants came to Gaul from the north, Britain, the Netherlands, or Germany, not from a theorized location in the Atlantic Ocean to the southwest. Instead, the Celts who dwelled along the ocean were reported to venerate twin gods, Dioscuri, who appeared to them coming from that ocean. During the early 1st century, the Hellenistic Jewish philosopher Philo wrote about the destruction of Atlantis in his On the Eternity of the World, 26.141, in a longer passage allegedly citing Aristotle's successor Theophrastus. The theologian Joseph Barber Lightfoot, Apostolic Fathers, 1885, 2, p. 84, noted on this passage, Clement may possibly be referring to some known, but hardly accessible land, lying without the Pillars of Hercules. But more probably he contemplated some unknown land in the far west beyond the ocean, like the fabled Atlantis of Plato. Other early Christian writers wrote about Atlantis, although they had mixed views on whether it once existed or was an untrustworthy myth of pagan origin. Tertullian believed Atlantis was once real and wrote that in the Atlantic Ocean once existed, the isle, that was equal in size to Libya or Asia, referring to Plato's geographical description of Atlantis. The early Christian apologist writer Arnobius also believed Atlantis once existed, but blamed its destruction on pagans. Cosmas Indigo Plustes in the 6th century wrote of Atlantis in his Christian Topography in an attempt to prove his theory that the world was flat and surrounded by water. Aside from Plato's original account, modern interpretations regarding Atlantis are an amalgamation of diverse, speculative movements that began in the 16th century, when scholars began to identify Atlantis with the New World. Francisco López de Gamarra was the first to state that Plato was referring to America, as did Francis Bacon and Alexander von Humboldt. Janus Johannes Burchard said in 1663, Orb novo non novo, the New World is not new. Athanasius Kircher accepted Plato's account as literally true, describing Atlantis as a small continent in the Atlantic Ocean. Contemporary perceptions of Atlantis share roots with Mayanism, which can be traced to the beginning of the modern age, when European imaginations were fueled by their initial encounters with the indigenous peoples of the Americas. From this era sprang apocalyptic and utopian visions that would inspire many subsequent generations of theorists. Most of these interpretations are considered pseudo-history, pseudo-science, or pseudo-archaeology, as they have presented their works as academic or scientific, but lack the standards or criteria. The Flemish cartographer and geographer Abraham Ortelius is believed to have been the first person to imagine that the continents were joined together before drifting to their present positions. In the 1596 edition of his Thesaurus Geographicus he wrote, unless it be a fable, the island of Gadir or Goddess will be the remaining part of the island of Atlantis or America, which was not sunk, as Plato reports in the Timaeus, so much as torn away from Europe and Africa by earthquakes and flood. The traces of the ruptures are shown by the projections of Europe and Africa and the indentations of America in the parts of the coasts off these three said lands that face each other to anyone who, using a map of the world, carefully considered them. So that anyone may say with Strabo in Book 2, that what Plato says of the island of Atlantis on the authority of Solon is not a figment. The term utopia, from no place, was coined by Sir Thomas More in his 16th century work of fiction Utopia. Inspired by Plato's Atlantis and travelers' accounts of the Americas, More described an imaginary land set in the New World. His idealistic vision established a connection between the Americas and utopian societies, a theme that Bacon discussed in The New Atlantis, circa 1623. A character in the narrative gives a history of Atlantis that is similar to Plato's and places Atlantis in America. People had begun believing that the Mayan and Aztec ruins could possibly be the remnants of Atlantis. Much speculation began as to the origins of the Maya, which led to a variety of narratives and publications that tried to rationalize the discoveries within the context of the Bible and that had undertones of racism in their connections between the Old and New World. The Europeans believed the indigenous people to be inferior and incapable of building that which was now in ruins, and by sharing a common history, they insinuate that another race must have been responsible. In the middle and late 19th century, several renowned Mesoamerican scholars, starting with Charles Etienne Brossard de Bourbourg, and including Edward Herbert Thompson and Augustus Laplanjan, formally proposed that Atlantis was somehow related to Mayan and Aztec culture. The French scholar Brossard de Bourbourg traveled extensively through Mesoamerica in the mid-1800s, and was renowned for his translations of Mayan texts, most notably the sacred book Popol Vuh, as well as a comprehensive history of the region. Soon after these publications, however, Brossard de Bourbourg loses academic credibility, due to his claim that the Maya peoples had descended from the Toltecs, people he believed were the surviving population of the racially superior civilization of Atlantis. His work, combined with the skillful, romantic illustrations of Jean Frederick Waldeck, which visually alluded to Egypt and other aspects of the Old World, created an authoritative fantasy that excited much interest in the connections between worlds. Inspired by Brossard de Bourbourg's diffusion theories, the pseudo-archaeologist Augustus Laplanjan traveled to Mesoamerica and performed some of the first excavations of many famous Mayan ruins. Laplanjan invented narratives, such as the Kingdom of Mu Saga, which romantically drew connections to him, his wife Alice, and Egyptian deities Osiris and Isis, as well as to Heinrich Schliemann, who had just discovered the ancient city of Troy from Homer's epic poetry that had been described as merely mythical. He also believed that he had found connections between the Greek and Mayan languages, which produced a narrative of the destruction of Atlantis. The 1882 publication of by Ignatius L. Donnelly stimulated much popular interest in Atlantis. He was greatly inspired by early works in Mayanism, and like them, attempted to establish that all known ancient civilizations were descended from Atlantis, which he saw as a technologically sophisticated, more advanced culture. Donnelly drew parallels between creation stories in the Old and New Worlds, attributing the connections to Atlantis, where he believed the biblical Garden of Eden existed. As implied by the title of his book, he also believed that Atlantis was destroyed by the Great Flood mentioned in the Bible. Donnelly is credited as the father of the 19th century Atlantis revival and is the reason the myth endures today. He unintentionally promoted an alternative method of inquiry to history and science, and the idea that myths contain hidden information that opens them to ingenious interpretation by people who believe they have new or special insight. The Russian mystic Helena Petrovna Blavatsky and her partner Henry Steele Olcott founded their Theosophical Society in the 1870s with a philosophy that combined Western Romanticism and Eastern religious concepts. Blavatsky and her followers in this group are often cited as the founders of New Age and other spiritual movements. Blavatsky took up Donnelly's interpretations when she wrote The Secret Doctrine, 1888. Which she claimed was originally dictated in Atlantis. She maintained that the Atlanteans were cultural heroes, contrary to Plato, who describes them mainly as a military threat. She believed in a form of racial evolution, as opposed to primate evolution, in which the Atlanteans were the fourth root race, succeeded by the fifth and most superior Aryan race, the modern human race. The Theosophists believed that the civilization of Atlantis reached its peak between 1 million and 900,000 years ago, but destroyed itself through internal warfare brought about by the dangerous use of psychic and supernatural powers of the inhabitants. Rudolf Steiner, the founder of Anthroposophy and Waldorf schools, along with other well-known Theosophists, such as Annie Besant, also wrote of cultural evolution in much the same vein. Some subsequent occultists have followed Blavatsky, at least to the point of tracing the lineage of occult practices back to Atlantis. Among the most famous is Dionne Fortune in her esoteric orders and their work. Blavatsky was also inspired by the work of the 18th-century astronomer Jean Sylvain Bailly, who had orientalized the Atlantis myth in his mythical continent of Hyperborea, a reference to Greek myths featuring a northern European region of the same name, home to a giant, godlike race. Dan Edelstein claims that her reshaping of this theory in The Secret Doctrine provided the Nazis with a mythological precedent and a pretext for their ideological platform and their subsequent genocide. However, Blavatsky's writings mention that the Atlantean were in fact olive-skinned peoples with Mongoloid traits who were the ancestors of modern Native Americans, Mongolians, and Malayans. Julius Evola's writing in 1934 also suggested that the Atlanteans were Hyperborean, Nordic supermen who originated at the North Pole, see Thule. Similarly, Alfred Rosenberg, in The Myth of the 20th Century, 1930, spoke of a Nordic Atlantean or Aryan Nordic master race. These ideas may contradict the beliefs of several esoteric and theosophic groups that, on the contrary, thought that the Atlanteans were non-Caucasian brown-skinned peoples. Also, some esoteric groups, including the Theosophic Society, does not consider Atlantean society to have been superior or utopian. On the contrary, they consider a lower stage on evolution. Edgar Cayce was a man from humble upbringings in Kentucky who allegedly possessed psychic abilities, which were performed from a trance-like state. In addition to allegedly healing the sick from this state, he also spoke frequently on the topic of Atlantis. In his life readings, he purportedly revealed that many of his subjects were reincarnations of people who had lived on Atlantis. By tapping into their collective consciousness, the Akashic Records, a term borrowed from Theosophy, he declared that he was able to give detailed descriptions of the lost continent. He also asserted that Atlantis would rise again in the 1960s, sparking much popularity of the myth in that decade, and that there is a Hall of Records beneath the Egyptian Sphinx, which holds the historical texts of Atlantis. As continental drift became widely accepted during the 1960s, and the increased understanding of plate tectonics demonstrated the impossibility of a lost continent in the geologically recent past, most lost continent theories of Atlantis began to wane in popularity. Plato scholar Julia Ennis, Regents Professor of Philosophy at the University of Arizona, had this to say on the matter. One of the proposed explanations for the historical context of the Atlantis story is a warning of Plato to his contemporary 4th century fellow citizens against their striving for naval power. Kenneth Fetter points out that Critias's story in the Timaeus provides a major clue. In the dialogue, Critias says, referring to Socrates' hypothetical society. Fetter quotes A. E. Taylor, who wrote, "We could not be told much more plainly that the whole narrative of Solon's conversation with the priests and his intention of writing the poem about Atlantis are an invention of Plato's fancy." Since Donnelly's day, there have been dozens of locations proposed for Atlantis, to the point where the name has become a generic concept, divorced from the specifics of Plato's account. This is reflected in the fact that many proposed sites are not within the Atlantic at all. Few today are scholarly or archaeological hypotheses, while others have been made by psychic, for example, Edgar Cayce, or other pseudoscientific means. The Atlantis researchers Jacques Collina Girard and Georgios Diaz Montexano, for instance, each claim the other's hypothesis is pseudoscience. Many of the proposed sites share some of the characteristics of the Atlantis story: water, catastrophic end, relevant time period, but none has been demonstrated to be a true historical Atlantis. Most of the historically proposed locations are in or near the Mediterranean Sea. Islands such as Sardinia, Crete, Santorini, Thera, Sicily, Cyprus, and Malta, land-based cities or states such as Troy, Tartessos, and Tantalus, in the province of Manisa, Turkey, Israel Sinai or Canaan, and northwestern Africa. The Thera eruption, dated to the 17th or 16th century BC, caused a large tsunami that some experts hypothesize devastated the Minoan civilization, the nearby island of Crete, further leading some to believe that this may have been the catastrophe that inspired the story. In the area of the Black Sea, the following locations have been proposed: Bosporus and Ancona, a legendary place near Trabzon. Others have noted that, before the 6th century BC, the mountains on either side of the Gulf of Laconia were called the Pillars of Hercules, and they could be the geographical location being described in ancient reports upon which Plato was basing his story. The mountains stood at either side of the southernmost gulf in Greece, the largest in the Peloponnese, and that gulf opens onto the Mediterranean Sea. If from the beginning of discussions, misinterpretation of Gibraltar as the location rather than being at the Gulf of Laconia would lend itself to many erroneous concepts regarding the location of Atlantis, Plato may have not been aware of the difference. The Laconian pillars open to the south toward Crete and beyond which is Egypt. The Thera eruption and the Late Bronze Age collapse affected that area and might have been the devastation to which the sources used by Plato referred. Significant events such as these would have been likely material for tales passed from one generation to another for almost 1,000 years. The location of Atlantis in the Atlantic Ocean has a certain appeal given the closely related names. Popular culture often places Atlantis there, perpetuating the original Platonic setting as they understand it. The Canary Islands and Madeira Islands have been identified as a possible location, west of the Straits of Gibraltar, but in relative proximity to the Mediterranean Sea. Detailed studies of their geomorphology and geology have demonstrated, however, that they have been steadily uplifted, without any significant periods of subsidence, over the last 4 million years, by geologic processes such as erosional unloading, gravitational unloading, lithospheric flexure induced by adjacent islands, and volcanic underplating. Various islands or island groups in the Atlantic were also identified as possible locations, notably the Azores. Similarly, cores of sediment covering the ocean bottom surrounding the Azores and other evidence demonstrate that it has been an undersea plateau for millions of years. The submerged island of Spartel near the Strait of Gibraltar has also been suggested. Several hypotheses place the sunken island in northern Europe, including Doggerland in the North Sea, and Sweden, by Olaf Rudbeck in Atland, 1672-1702. Doggerland, as well as Viking Bergen Island, is thought to have been flooded by a megatsunami following the Storgaslide of circa 6100 BC. Some have proposed the Celtic Shelf as a possible location, and that there is a link to Ireland. In 2011, a team, working on a documentary for the National Geographic Channel, led by Professor Richard Freund from the University of Hartford, claimed to have found possible evidence of Atlantis in southwestern Andalusia. The team identified its possible location within the marshlands of the Doñana National Park, in the area that once was the Lacus Ligustinus, between the Huelva, Cádiz, and Seville provinces, and they speculated that Atlantis had been destroyed by a tsunami, extrapolating results from a previous study by Spanish researchers, published 4 years earlier. Spanish scientists have dismissed Freund's speculations, claiming that he sensationalized their work. The anthropologist Juan Villarias Robles, who works with the Spanish National Research Council, said, "Richard Freund was a newcomer to our project and appeared to be involved in his own very controversial issue concerning King Solomon's search for ivory and gold in Tartessos, the well-documented settlement in the Doñana area established in the first millennium BC, and described Freund's claims as fanciful." A similar theory had previously been put forward by a German researcher, Rainer W. Kuhne, that is based only on satellite imagery and places Atlantis in the Marismas de Hinojos, north of the city of Cadiz. Before that, the historian Adolf Schalten had stated in the 1920s that Plato had used Tartessos as the basis for his Atlantis myth. Several writers have speculated that Antarctica is the site of Atlantis, while others have proposed Caribbean locations such as the alleged Cuban sunken city off the Guanacabibes Peninsula in Cuba, the Bahamas, and the Bermuda Triangle. Areas in the Pacific and Indian Oceans have also been proposed, including Indonesia, i.e. Sundaland. The stories of a lost continent off the coast of India, named Kumari Kondam, have inspired some to draw parallels to Atlantis. In order to give his account of Atlantis verisimilitude, Plato mentions that the story was heard by Solon in Egypt, and transmitted orally over several generations through the family of Dropides, until it reached Critias, a dialogue speaker in Timaeus and Critias. Solon had supposedly tried to adapt the Atlantis oral tradition into a poem, that if published, was to be greater than the works of Hesiod and Homer. While it was never completed, Solon passed on the story to Dropides. Modern classicists deny the existence of Solon's Atlantis poem and the story as an oral tradition. Instead, Plato is thought to be the sole inventor or fabricator. Hellenicus of Lesbos used the word Atlantis as the title for a poem published before Plato, a fragment of which may be Oxyrhynchus Papyrus 11:1359. This work only describes the Atlantides, the daughters of Atlas, however, and has no relation to Plato's Atlantis account. In the New Era, the 3rd century AD Neoplatonist Zodicus wrote an epic poem based on Plato's account of Atlantis. Plato's work may already have inspired parodic imitation, however. Writing only a few decades after the Timaeus and Critias, the historian Theopompus of Chios wrote of a land beyond the ocean known as Meropis. This description was included in Book 8 of his Philippica, which contains a dialogue between Silenus and King Midas. Silenus describes the Meropids, a race of men who grow to twice normal size, and inhabit 2 cities on the island of Meropis, Eusebes, Pious Town, and Machimos, Fighting Town. He also reports that an army of 10 million soldiers crossed the ocean to conquer Hyperborea, but abandoned this proposal when they realized that the Hyperboreans were the luckiest people on Earth. Heinz Gundren Selrath has argued that these and other details of Silenus' story are meant as imitation and exaggeration of the Atlantis story, by parody, for the purpose of exposing Plato's ideas to ridicule. The creation of utopian and dystopian fictions was renewed after the Renaissance, most notably in Francis Bacon's New Atlantis, 1627, the description of an ideal society that he located off the western coast of America. Thomas Hayrick, 1649-1694, followed him with The New Atlantis, 1687, a satirical poem in three parts. His new continent of uncertain location, perhaps even a floating island either in the sea or the sky, serves as background for his exposure of what he described in a second edition as a true character of popery and Jesuitism. The title of The New Atlantis by Delarivier Manley, 1709, distinguished from the two others by the single letter, is an equally dystopian work but set this time on a fictional Mediterranean island. In it, sexual violence and exploitation is made a metaphor for the hypocritical behavior of politicians in their dealings with the general public. In Manley's case, the target of satire was the Whig Party, while in David McLean Perry's The Scarlet Empire, 1906, it is socialized mispracticed in foundered Atlantis. It was followed in Russia by Velimir Klevnikov's poem The Fall of Atlantis, Gibel Atlantidae, 1912, which is set in a future rationalist dystopia that has discovered the secret of immortality and is so dedicated to progress that it has lost touch with the past. When the high priest of this ideology is tempted by a slave girl into an act of irrationality, he murders her and precipitates a second flood, above which her severed head floats vengefully among the stars. A slightly later work, The Ancient of Atlantis, Boston, 1915, by Albert Armstrong Manship, expounds the Atlantean wisdom that is to redeem the earth. Its three parts consist of a verse narrative of the life and training of an Atlantean wise one, followed by his utopian moral teachings, and then a psychic drama set in modern times in which a reincarnated child embodying the lost wisdom is reborn on earth. In Hispanic eyes, Atlantis had a more intimate interpretation. The land had been a colonial power which, although it had brought civilization to ancient Europe, had also enslaved its peoples. Its tyrannical fall from grace had contributed to the fate that had overtaken it, but now its disappearance had unbalanced the world. This was the point of view of Jack and Verdiguer's vast mythological epic La Atlantida, 1877. After the sinking of the former continent, Hercules travels east across the Atlantic to found the city of Barcelona and then departs westward again to the Hesperides. The story is told by a hermit to a shipwrecked mariner, who is inspired to follow in his tracks and so call the new world into existence to redress the balance of the old. This mariner, of course, was Christopher Columbus. Verdiguer's poem was written in Catalan, but was widely translated in both Europe and Hispanoamerica. One response was the similarly entitled Argentinian Atlantida of Olegario Victor Andrade, 1881, which sees an enchanted Atlantis that Plato foresaw, a golden promise to the fruitful race of Latins. The bad example of the colonizing world remains, however. José Juan Tableta characterizes its threat in his De Atlantida, 1894, through the beguiling picture of the lost world populated by the underwater creatures of classical myth, among whom is the siren of its final stanza. With there is a similar ambivalence in Janus Jurhua's sixth stanza Atlantis, 1917, where a celebration of the Faroese linguistic revival grants it an ancient pedigree by linking Greek to Norse legend. In the poem, a female figure rising from the sea against a background of classical palaces is recognized as a priestess of Atlantis. The poet recalls that the pharaohs lie there in the North Atlantic Ocean / where before lay the poet dreamt lands, but also that in Norse belief, such a figure only appears to those about to drown. The fact that Atlantis is a lost land has made of it a metaphor for something no longer attainable. For the American poet Edith Willis Lind Forbes, 1865-1945, the lost Atlantis stands for idealization of the past. The present moment can only be treasured once that is realized. Ella Wheeler Wilcox finds the location of the lost land, 1910, in one's carefree youthful past. Similarly, for the Irish poet Evan Boland in Atlantis, a lost sonnet, 2007, the idea was defined when the old fable makers searched hard for a word / to convey that what is gone forever. For some male poets too, the idea of Atlantis is constructed from what cannot be obtained. Charles Bewley in his Newdigate Prize poem, 1910, thinks it grows from dissatisfaction with one's condition, in a dream of Atlantis. Similarly for the Australian Gary Catalano in a 1982 prose poem, it is a vision that sank under the weight of its own perfection. W. H. Auden, however, suggests a way out of such frustration through the metaphor of journeying toward Atlantis in his poem of 1941. While traveling, he advises the one setting out, "You will meet with many definitions of the goal in view, only realizing at the end that the way has all the time ultimately inward." art. A few late 19th century verse narratives complement the genre of fiction that was beginning to be written at the same period. Two of them report the disaster that overtook the continent as related by long-lived survivors. In Frederick Tennyson's Atlantis, 1888, an ancient Greek mariner sails west and discovers an inhabited island, which is all that remains of the former kingdom. He learns of its end and views the shattered remnant of its former glory, from which a few had escaped to set up the Mediterranean civilizations. In the second, Mona, Queen of Lost Atlantis, an idyllic re-embodiment of long-forgotten history, Los Angeles, CA 1925, by James Loke Dryden, 1840-1925, the story is told in a series of visions. Aesir is taken to Mona's burial chamber in the ruins of Atlantis, where she revives and describes the catastrophe. There follows a survey of the lost civilizations off Hyperborea and Lemuria as well as Atlantis, accompanied by much spiritualist lore. William Walton Hoskins, 1856-1919, admits to the readers of his Atlantis and other poems, Cleveland O, 1881, that he is only 24. Its melodramatic plot concerns the poisoning of the descendant of godborn kings. The usurping poisoner is poisoned in his turn, following which the continent is swallowed in the waves. Asian Gods People the Landscape of the Lost Island, Ottawa 1889, by Edward Taylor Fletcher, 1816-97. An angel foresees impending catastrophe and that the people will be allowed to escape if their semi-divine rulers will sacrifice themselves. A final example, Edward N. Beecher's The Lost Atlantis or The Great Deluge of All, Cleveland O, 1898, is just a doggerel vehicle for its author's opinions that the continent was the location of the Garden of Eden, that Darwin's theory of evolution is correct, as are Donnelly's views. Atlantis was to become a theme in Russia following the 1890s, taken up in unfinished poems by Valery Bryusov and Konstantin Balmont, as well as in a drama by the schoolgirl Larissa Reisner. One other long narrative poem was published in New York by George V. Golic Vastov. His 250-page The Fall of Atlantis, 1938, records how High Priest, distressed by the prevailing degeneracy of the ruling classes, seeks to create an androgynous being from royal twins as a means to overcome this polarity. When he is unable to control the forces unleashed by his occult ceremony, the continent is destroyed. The Spanish composer Manuel de Falla worked on a dramatic cantata based on Verdaguer's La Atlántida during the last 20 years of his life. The name has been affixed to symphonies by Janis Ivanov's, 1941, Richard Nunes, and Vaclav Buzek, 2009. There was also the symphonic celebration of Alan Hovhaness, Fanfare for the New Atlantis, Opus 281, 1975. The Bohemian-American composer and arranger Vincent Frank Safranek wrote Atlantis, The Lost Continent, Suite in Four Parts, A Nocturne and Morning Hymn of Praise, 2. A Court Function, 3. I Love Thee, The Prince and Anna, 4. The Destruction of Atlantis, for military, concert, band in 1913. The 1968 song Atlantis by Scottish singer Donovan described Atlantis and its hypothetical fate. It charted in several countries, reaching number 1 in Switzerland in 1969 and as high as number 7 in the United States. Paintings of the submersion of Atlantis are comparatively rare. In the 17th century there was François de Nome's The Fall of Atlantis, which shows a tidal wave surging toward a Baroque city frontage. The style of architecture apart, it is not very different from Nicholas Roerich's The Last of Atlantis of 1928. The most dramatic depiction of the catastrophe was Leon Bakst's Ancient Terror, Terra Antiquis, 1908, although it does not name Atlantis directly. It is a mountaintop view of a rocky bay breached by the sea, which is washing inland about the tall structures of an ancient city. A streak of lightning crosses the upper half of the painting, while below it rises the impassive figure of an enigmatic goddess who holds a blue dove between her breasts. Vyacheslav Ivanov identified the subject as Atlantis in a public lecture on the painting given in 1909, the year it was first exhibited, and he has been followed by other commentators in the years since. Sculptures referencing Atlantis have often been stylized single figures. One of the earliest was Einar Jonsson's The King of Atlantis, 1919-1922, now in the garden of his museum in Reykjavik. It represents a single figure, clad in a belted skirt and wearing a large triangular helmet, who sits on an ornate throne supported between two young bulls. The Walking Female entitled Atlantis, 1946, by Ivan Meshtrovich was from a series inspired by ancient Greek figures with the symbolical meaning of unjustified suffering. In the case of the Brussels fountain feature known as the Man of Atlantis, 2003, by the Belgian sculptor, the 4-meter-tall figure wearing a diving suit steps from a plinth into the spray. It looks lighthearted, but the artist's comment on it makes a serious point, because habitable land will be scarce, it is no longer improbable that we will return to the water in the long term. As a result, a portion of the population will mutate into fish-like creatures. Global warming and rising water levels are practical problems for the world in general and here in the Netherlands in particular. Robert Smithson's hypothetical continent, Map of Broken Clear Glass, Atlantis, was first created as a photographical project on Lovelady's Island, NJ in 1969, and then recreated as a gallery installation of broken glass. On this he commented that he liked landscapes that suggest prehistory, and this is borne out by the original conceptual drawing of the work that includes an inset map of the continent sited off the coast of Africa and at the straits into the Mediterranean. Underwater geography. General. Ancient sources. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.